The Commission on Elections, or COMELEC, says a viral video circulating online showed the destruction of mock ballots in Cotabato City. The clip, which now has over a million views on Twitter, showed two uniformed personnel ripping ballots. The COMELEC says those were just mock ballots used to train voters.
Yung pong balot ang pinakita, napakalabo pa, may pinakita, may posisyon, may mga shade. Tingnan niyo po ha. Oo. Pero lumayo yung camera habang nakalayo siya, tapos pinupunit, tingnan niyo po, blanco yung balota. Yung po ay yung po yung mga fake na balota na pwede pong ginamit yan para doon sa mga pagtitrain.
But COMELEC spokesperson Rex Laudianco says the incident will be investigated, adding those could be unused or spoiled ballots.
Ang una pong indications, although these reports are yet to be vetted, parang ang nangyari po yata that they are tearing the unused ballots, but perhaps parang spoiled ballot po yata, kasi parang yung first part lang po, yung may shade, yung the succeeding parts po hindi na natin nakita. But then again, this will be investigated thoroughly and we will be reporting to the public. We will be very transparent about this po. To be honest about it, ang una ko pong naisip, baka nagkamali yung mga special electoral boards ng pagpunit, kasi meron po tayong procedure that we will be tearing in half the unused ballots.
The COMELEC earlier said the May 9 polls were clean and successful. That's despite numerous reports of alleged irregularities and over 1,000 vote counting machines that malfunctioned on election day. The poll body, meanwhile, says there's no truth to claims. COMELEC is asking the Parish Pastoral Council for Responsible Voting, or PPCRV, to stop its own count of election results. PPCRV is the citizen arm of COMELEC. It is tasked to manually encode the printed copies of poll results to verify if they match with the electronic results from COMELEC's transparency server.
PPCRV is vested with that independence that they are our partners. PPCRV is not under COMELEC and we cannot order them to stop. Partners po kami dito. In fact, kung dati po ang ginagawa ni PPCRV, yung electronic results, sinasummary po nila. But this time, to further vet the elections, alam niyo po ang ginagawa nila? They're not encoding the electronically transmitted results. What they are encoding are the printed ERs.
As for PPCRV, it's not seeing any discrepancies in their manual vote count.
Based on the data that we are receiving, yeah, we are not seeing any thing that should be of any concern. Mm-hmm. Again, just to emphasize as well, we at PPCRV will be the first one to let you know if there's anything that should be of concern to us. And our data is open to anyone, political parties, representatives of any candidates.
A poll watchdog calls for the blacklisting of Smartmatic following reports of vote counting machine glitches. Contra Dayo convener Danilo Arau says most of the complaints they got on election day were about long lines and malfunctioning VCMs. He says those glitches may have disappointed some first-time voters. Arau adds this year's polls could be the most problematic automated elections in the Philippines.
Isipin nyo na lang, Johnson, ha? Nandoon ka sa polling precinct, umaga pa, gabi na, napapanood mo sa TV, sa ABS-CBN, na nagbibilangan na, tapos ikaw, naghihintay ka pa rin na makaboto. So, nakakadurog po ng puso yon. At yun yung masasabi nating concrete anecdotal evidence na meron talagang kapalpakan ang Smartmatic. Dapat ma-blacklist na yan, palayasin na sana yan sa Pilipinas. At ang COMELEC, dapat investigahan yung lahat ng mga nangyaring problema at aberya. At huwag sabihing minor problems lang ito. Oh. Hindi po minor ang potential disenfranchisement.
Oh. Another election watchdog supports the call to blacklist Smartmatic. The National Citizens Movement for Free Elections, or NAMFREL, points out the current voting system lacks transparency. To remove doubts on the accuracy of vote counting machines, NAMFRL says a hybrid setup should be implemented.
Yesterday, I was in a discussion with a pretty big group, and they were all talking about can we trust the automated elections, etc., etc. And after a sudden discussion, I said, you know, we won't even have to be talking about this. If we had manual elections, we had manual counting at the precinct level, because that would remove the doubt on the accuracy of the machines that we're using now, Smartmatic machines. Remove that and manually count. Only it will only take about what, 5 hours to count the votes in the precincts. But what we would gain would be the transparency of our elections.
NAMFRL also reminds the public to accept the outcome of the elections.
However, having said that, we have to be aware that there are candidates who might cheat. And when that happens, make sure that you are able to file a protest. Make sure that you get enough evidence so that the protest can be upheld. I always say, we talk about voter education. Voter education should start early. Even in grade school, we have to teach the pupils voter education and civic education. So that love for country, for example, this should be taught early in grade school, so that we don't even have. I'm dreaming of a future where we don't even need citizens' arms during elections, because everybody will want to watch.
The UP College of Mass Communication denounces efforts to undermine the country's democratic processes. In a statement, it says the spread of disinformation to mislead the public has been evident in this year's elections. It also called out candidates who have evaded public accountability by avoiding media interviews and being absent in public debates. Moving forward, Dean Fernando Paragas urges media institutions to take more steps to fight fake news and for the next administration to be truthful.
That begins with holding or resuming the regular press conferences that were a hallmark of our democracy before, but has since disappeared as a practice, at least in the office of the president, for instance. I do not personally know the top officials, right? We only know them through media. So if the information that we get through media, whether legacy or social media, is quite questionable, then we are not really making informed decisions.
A new era of unity between the two highest leaders in the land. That's what the spokesperson of Sara Duterte is touting once the Davao City Mayor and presumptive President Marcos begin their terms. Unlike the Marcos-Duterte tandem, the president and the vice president in past administrations usually come from different political parties.
She has demonstrated in these past months, she has worked very well with our president-elect Bongbong Marcos. And what we foresee is a very good working relationship that is based on a common and united principle of governance, and that is unity and love of country.
Given a choice for a cabinet position, Frasco says Duterte is eyeing the post of defense secretary.
Having been at the forefront of ensuring the peace and order of the very peaceful city of Davao, I think that Vice President-elect Sara Duterte would be able to give a lot of practical experience and advice as far as ensuring the territorial integrity and security of our borders.
The U.S. ready to work with the new Philippine government on key human rights and regional priorities. U.S. State Department spokesman Ned Price says Washington will continue collaborating with the next administration to advance a free and open Indo-Pacific. Price, meanwhile, brushed off the question about whether he had any concerns on the looming presidency of the son of the late dictator Ferdinand Marcos. He said, as far as he's concerned, the voting was done in line with international standards and without significant incident. Senate President Vicente Soto III names 7 senators who will form the Senate contingency to the National Board of Canvassers. They are Senators Amy Marcos, Franklin Drilon, Mig Subiri, Francis Tolentino, Pia Cayetano, Nancy Binay, and Grace Poe. Senators Sonny Angara and Cynthia Villar, meanwhile, will serve as alternates. 173 certificates of canvass and election returns will be stored at the Senate premises until they convene and hold a joint session with the House of Representatives into the NBOC. Both houses of Congress are tasked under the Constitution to consolidate and canvass all votes for the President and Vice President and proclaim the winners. The Philippine poll body's failure to decide on the disqualification cases against Bongbong Marcos on time is a disservice to the presidential bet and the petitioners. That's according to political analyst Tony Lavinia. The COMELEC en banc decided to junk a total of 4 appeals seeking to bar Marcos from the polls on Tuesday, a day after the elections.
There's a major failure in this election, which is that the COMELEC failed to decide the Marcos disqualification cases on time. Oh, that really is a disservice to Senator Marcos and a disservice to the petitioners, because now they have to go to the Supreme Court with a landslide victory by Marcos on the numbers. And the Supreme Court will have to be faced with this decision whether they should even take on a case involving very important points of law about the disqualifications of a candidate, while at the same time in the face of an election that's already been done.
Another petitioner in the Marcos disqualification cases takes their fight to the Supreme Court. The group, Campaign Against the Return of the Marcoses and Martial Law, or CARMA, accused the COMELEC of taking its time to uphold the lies of the Marcoses and preempt their next move. CARMA asserts allowing a convict like Marcos to run for public office is a slap on the faces of martial law victims. U.S. banking giant J.P. Morgan drops the Philippines to the bottom of its ASEAN investment preference list. It ranked the Philippines behind close neighbors Vietnam, Singapore, Thailand, and Malaysia. The report flagged the risks from high public debt and surging inflation, which it said would slow economic growth and hurt corporate profits. It also advised investors to lessen their exposure to local stocks as it downgrades the Philippines to underweight from neutral. J.P. Morgan said Philippine equities face several challenges, including some transition pains as a new administration enters. Meanwhile, Fitch sees policy continuity in the Philippines following the apparent victory of presidential bet Bongbong Marcos. The Fitch Group's Country Risk and Industry Research Unit raised the Philippines' short-term political risk index score from 64 to 66.5, as it expects a smooth transition of power. It also sees Marcos carrying on the Duterte administration's infrastructure push while striving to maintain a delicate balancing act between the U.S. and China in terms of foreign policy.